Hi everyone. I am Emrah Kocaman from Hazelcast Istanbul office. I've been working in the software industry for about an eight year now, especially in the enterprise part. And one of my employees was BNP Paribas Group in Turkey called TEP. It's a joint venture. And for over a year and a half now, I've been working for Hazelcast and Hazelcast integration team. Let's look at the agenda now. First, we start with essentials. We will see what's Hazelcast. Then we will do a hands-on demo. Then we will look at the details of how Hazelcast distributes data. Then we will have an overview of Hazelcast features. Have you ever heard of Hazelcast before? Okay. Yeah, clap. Then, have you used it, actually? Yeah, you tried it? You? Yeah, you just tried. Anyone using it in production? Or why don't you use in production? Yeah, okay. Basically, Hazelcast is an in-memory data grid solution. What do we mean by in-memory data grid? It's an in-memory data storage. Consists of lots of data structures like distributed implementations of map, queues, sets maybe. Then also it's an in-memory data messaging platform, which implements again the distributed versions of queues. It's just Java util queue interface. And also it behaves like an in-memory data computing platform. You don't just keep the data in memory, also you can process it, distributed process it. So beyond that, Hazelcast is an open source project. It's Apache 2 license. You can fork it and develop your own fork, for example. It's free. Hazelcast is lightweight. It has no dependency. We don't depend on any other third-party libraries. Also, beyond it is independency of libraries, it is also very simple to program it. We will see in a short while in the demo also. Because Hazelcast implements the distributed versions of queues, the Java util queue, Java util map interfaces. So you can program it just like using the regular map and queue implementations. Also, Hazelcast is a company. It's the name of the company also. How do we make money from this company? We have an enterprise version of Hazelcast, and we have support contracts, and we are providing training and consultancy. If you are interested in the enterprise version or any support contract or training, the guy is Martin. You can contact him. basically, Hazelcast is a Java library. It consists of only one jar. It's around 6 megabytes. It's a small jar, but it's packed full of features. Let's see the basic features of Hazelcast. First, being an in-memory data grid, this is the nature of being an in-memory data grid. It's scalable. What I mean by scalable is it doesn't, you can choose, depending on your requirements, you can choose to scale out or scale up. For example, you have only one server and you can have hundreds of gigabytes of RAM only on a single server. Or you can choose the smarter way and the cheaper way also. You can scale out. You can easily add servers to your server farm, and they don't need to be so powerful as this Hulk. But when you have when you have more than one server, you will have redundancy. Also, to scale up, you need to, most of the time, you need to shut down your servers to upgrade it. For example, if you need more RAM or more CPU power, you need to update your server. And during that time, it's a downtime for your application. But when you scale out, you only add new servers to your server farm without any interruption to your production system. Another main feature of Hazelcast is speed. It's fast because it's an in-memory data grid, so all the data is kept in memory, in RAM. Okay, here is a comparison of accessing data in different mediums. For example, the fastest one is the CPU's L1 cache. When you reference the data that resides in the L1 cache on cache of a CPU, then it is around half nanoseconds. The second fastest, or the third fastest, is L2 cache. This is 7 nanoseconds, and this is the main memory reference. This is where we kept the whole data in Hazelcast. We keep all data in memory reference. It is 100 nanoseconds. Since we cannot keep whole data in L1 cache and L2 cache of CPUs, they are very limited, you know, only 2-3 megabytes. The next meaningful solution is, of course, the main memory reference. So we keep the data here. So, for example, you can see that when you try to read data from an SSD disk, it takes around 150 microseconds. But sending the data over your local network is faster than accessing it on your SSD. So when you add new servers to your farm, it won't be a problem. The network won't be a problem for it. Beyond that, the memory is getting cheaper every day. So this is the now it is logical to keep all data in the memory. So, for example, let's look at the years. Now, in 1960s, the price per megabyte is around 400 Ks. So this is why in-memory data grid solutions didn't exist in these times. Now, coming to our days, now it is, as you can see, the megabyte price of it's like free, right? So it is logical to keep data in the RAM. Any objections here? Okay. So I think this is a misleading sentence. What are the main features of distributed? This is not so easy in all distributed application platforms. It's not so easy to write programs on it, software on it. You get vendor lock-in, for example. You can't get rid of them so easily. But Hazelcast is simple. As I said, we implement the distributed versions of Java util package, like Java util queue map. So it's very easy. It's very easy to use Hazelcast. Let's continue with a demo here to show you how easy it is. It is so easy that you can get it wrong. As I said, Hazelcast is Hazelcast only one jar, and it is here is a basic project. It's nothing more than a startup of a Maven project. It's just a Maven project that I create with IDEA. Let's see the dependencies here. As you can see, we only have one dependency here. We don't depend anything else. All you need is the Hazelcast jar. Let's start an Hazelcast instance. Well, before starting an Hazelcast instance, let's see how we use, let's remember how we use the app interface here. Okay. Let's see, we have a map. Okay, so I can speak without microphone, okay. Using a map is very easy, and you probably all you are using this implementation. What's the problem of the hash map, the in a distributed environment? Sorry? It's not thread safe. So how do you make it thread safe? Yeah, this is easy, right? Okay. Now our problem is the distributing data. When you use a concurrent hash map, you keep data only in one server, right? You need to distribute it to other servers to scale out. So how do you distribute it to other nodes? Do you have an idea, or have you used any distributed application platform before? Anyone? Okay. So you can use Hazelcast for it. All you need to do is starting an Hazelcast instance. Let's assign it to a variable. Okay. Now let's try running this. Okay. Now a Hazelcast node is started, but you have the map is not in the Hazelcast yet. All we need to do is it's very simple. You get the map from the Hazelcast. You want it from Hazelcast. It creates it for you. Oops. Instance, get map. Just give a name, whatever you want. Now, let's start it. So we have an already running Hazelcast instance before that I started just before that. Now that, as you can see, they see each other and they form a cluster now. And as we requested from Hazelcast to create a map, it's created on both nodes, so you can now easily access the data in all nodes. So let's try something different now. Now we have the key value here. We need to get it from another node, right? Since it's a distributed application. So we can say map. This is just, the map interface. Yeah, nothing more. So map get, it was key. Now I will create another instance, and this instance will see this key. As you can see now, we have three servers in our cluster, and the value is also here. Now it's so easy. So you put that data in another node, and you can get it from whatever node you want easily. Any questions so far? It's now three nodes. We have created three nodes now. As you can see, this is the first one, and you can see the logs. Then when I started the second one, it's joined here. Then I started the third one. They are all joined, and they form a cluster. There is no master node in Hazelcast. All nodes have equal responsibility. But they know where the data is located in which node. Each Hazelcast instance knows where the data is and where to send requests to get that data. Of course, data is stored in one node, but you can reach it in whichever node you want. Also, they are distributed. So when we put the key is hashed. We will look into the details of it. And an eligible member is selected to send that data. The data is kept in that node. Distributedly, so depending on the key, they will distribute it among all the servers. Yeah.
How do you know
which
node is which partition? Do you use a protocol like gossip or something like that?
It's an internal implementation, and we have the partition table. And it is distributed, and among all the nodes, and every node knows which partition is in which node, and so since it is static, and if you don't add a new server, it is static. The old partition owners are same. When you add a new server, the partitions will be rebalanced, and in that period, they will change again their partition tables. So every node knows in which partition is in which node.
If there is a problem of communication between the nodes, like a partition or something like that,
yeah. Okay, there's a heartbeat mechanism between nodes. So when they lose the heartbeat, they are assumed as they are lost, and data is backed up in other nodes. So the backup will come and will come to rescue. Sorry? Yeah, it's... Yeah, these are three different JVMs. So when you start this main class, it starts a new JVM. Yeah, the method doesn't end because this Hazelcast instance. You need to explicitly shut down the Hazelcast node. They are all running until you shut down. They will be all running. Okay. Any questions? More questions? Yeah. Hazelcast XML file. Yeah. So you want? this is the default Hazelcast XML file. This is a configuration file. I copied this from the Hazelcast jar. We provide the default Hazelcast XML file, which has sensible default values for data structures. Of course, you can customize it. And it is not needed, actually. It's not needed to be in the class path. So I just add it for demo purposes. If you delete it, it will run with defaults again. Yeah, you can. There's lots of customization options in this XML file. You can add your own serializers, maybe. There are lots of configuration options here, so you can customize it here. Okay. Let's try something else. So shut down these. Okay. Now you can, as I said, Hazelcast implements the map interface, but also provides additions to this interface. It's called IMAP. So let's change this bit. IMAP, this is the Hazelcast interface of map. This is an extension to map to add some distributing computing capabilities to map interface. One of them is, for example, entry listeners. You might want to listen the map operations, like map put operation. When an entry is added to your map, you might want to take some action on it. So it's very easy. It's very easy to do this in Hazelcast. Also, this will provide you some distributing computing capabilities beyond storage. You can do some distributed computing also. This is the interface. Oh, sorry, my entry unit listener. Re-edit. Okay. Now we just want to print to see what an event contains. And you need to register this event listener to your map. Map.add entry listener new. The second parameter true, which is default it's true, I guess. It decides to send value with this entry event. Entry event contains key and some statistics about the entry, the map entry. Also, then if your value is huge. For example, you are processing some PDF files or image files, and the value of your key is 100 megabytes. And if you try to send this event every node, you need to distribution means the serialization. So you need to serialize your data and send it over the wire. So if your value is too big, and you don't need to, if you don't need the value to process, only the, for example, only key and the stats are enough for you, you can choose not sending it for to gain some performance. Let's add entries to event in a loop. Map that. Value. Let's make this K I and value I. Okay. And put a sleep here to see the events. 1 second should be enough. Okay. Let's start this node again. Events are coming now. As you can see, each time you put a key value pair to the map, an event is fired. So we need this event to be distributed along all your servers. So let's start another one. Let's start another instance here. We can commit this. We don't need this because one member is doing this part. Okay, they have found each other now. Now the events also sent to this member. But when you add an event entry and add entry listener, to a map, it sends events all the nodes. If you want to, you may want to process only the local keys that you put. So when you put an entry to the map, it is the key value pair, this entry might not be kept in the node that you put it. It is because distributed, and it checks the it checks the key of the entry and decides which node owns that related partition for it, and send it to that node. So you only need you might want to see the only local events here. So you can add only local listeners. For example, start another node and add this at local entry. In that case, you don't need this parameter because it's local. So you can pass the reference of the value. It will not be serialized through the wire. So it is fine to pass the value here. Let's start this one. Okay, now we have three nodes cluster. Yeah, we need to, yep, it's here. Okay, as you can see, not all the events are coming to this member. Only the local ones are listed here. But for example, this one, it receives all the events. but this only receives the events of that its own partitions. Right. Any questions?
So for
it's not random. The key is hashed. It's okay. There is a consistent hashing algorithm. It hashes the key and decides which partition in which partition it belongs, and sends it to the related partition.
Based on the hash value.
Not round robin, but yeah, not round robin. Yeah, like that. Yeah. It's like that. But it's consistent. Yeah. Okay. Any other questions? Partitions are the value is the key value, the entry is stored only in one node, and this is the responsible of accessing it, and there is only one thread accessing it at one time. So when you try to write same key from different members, it will get in the queue of that thread. Okay, you need to use locks then. So there's also a locking mechanism in the map. If you think that more than one thread is accessing it, you need to lock it. Okay. Yeah, sure. It is always replicating. So when you put an entry to a node, first, it finds which node it belongs to, send the data there. Then this node, the owner of the data, sends the backup of it to a backup node.
So there is a master.
Every node is responsible of the partitions that it's on.
It's
the owner of it, yeah. But there's no global master.
Yeah. Master for partition, because you can only write to the master of that partition.
Yeah, sure.
You have to pass through that master to write to it, and then you can broadcast to the slave.
No, you don't broadcast it. The backup of the partition is known. So it only sends the backup node, not all nodes. It only sends the backup node. And when you try accessing the data, and if you are not in that owner node, you know the hash and the partition of the key and owner of that key, the node sends its request to the owner node and gets the value from there. It is configurable. You can have more than one backup. Yeah, you can have.
So that means that Hazelcast is not completely available if the master of the partition crashes for a period of time. There can be a short period of time.
Yeah, sure. Until the backups are backups are promoted. Yeah. But it is blocking operation, right? You cannot get any stale data or something else. When you try getting that data, you block there. So you can't have wrong data.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's blocked, and only that partition is blocked. And when you try to reach that, you wait there. So when you call map.get on a partition which is not available, for example, which is promoting, this partition thread is suspended. So you wait on this call until the backups are promoted. Yeah, okay. Also, we have this hot restart functionality coming in the next release. It's in 3.6. We are now in 3.5.3, and I think in a month or so, the 3.6 is coming. And hot restart functionality will save the data to hard drive when it's shut down. The node saves its data, and when you restart it, it reads the data from the disk and loads it directly to the memory. Okay. Sure. Yeah. It's not limited. As you have enough processing capability, enough memory among all distributed system, it's not limited. For example, there's a demo here. There's a demo on YouTube channel. It saves 1 terabyte of data in Amazon EC2 cluster, for example. Okay, so if you have processing power, you can save. Without any limit. It's on the heap, and when you save this much data in the heap, for example, a terabytes of data in the heap, there might be long GC pauses. So we also provide this. A functionality called high density caching, which saves the data off heap and get rid of GC pauses. But it's an enterprise feature. Questions? Okay, let's continue with our presentation. And we have mentioned about the backup, data backup policy. Default backup count is 1. So when you have a entry on one node, the backup of it will be on another node. We support maximum backup count to 6. And of course, backups are increasing the memory. So when you have 1K kilobytes of data in master node, then 1 kilobyte will be on the backup too. So if you have, you need to be careful about choosing this backup count depending on your heap size. most of the time backup, this default one is, I think, enough. But if you need more redundancy, you can increase it. And by the way, the backups are synchronous with the operation. So when you run the map put, it waits until its backup is complete. Okay. Also, we support async backup. If you don't need this sync backup functionality, you can use async this. Then it's the map put immediately returns when it puts the data to its owner node, and the backup will be done asynchronously. Let's see how data partitioning is done on the Hazelcast member with an animated slide. For example, I didn't mention that we have fixed number of partitions. It's default to 271. It is distributed among all the server nodes, and when you, of course, it can be changed, but once you started the Hazelcast, it's fixed and you cannot change it during runtime. As I said before, each key is hashed and partition is calculated. So each key falls into a partition. Here is a basic pseudo code of the implementation. Let's see what happens when a new node is added. Okay. So these are the upper ones are the owned entries, and the below ones are backups of that entries. Okay. So when a new node is added, a partition migration operation is triggered, and the partition table is recalculated again, and the responsible partitions are owned by this new member. And since every node knows the partition table and knows which keys belong to which partition, they start sending their not owned partitions now, sending to the new owner of this node. So, and of course, they are sending their backups also. Backups are also in the same, has the same logic with the real entries. Okay. Now it is okay. Then this after this migration operation is complete, D owns this data. And it also sends its backups to the other members also. Let's see the crash scenario here. Here the red ones are owned by B. I guess it's red. Red ones are owned by B, and assume that B is crashed. Do you have any guess for it? What will happen? Okay. As you can see, the backups are restored. Let me take this. Yeah. Okay. So the red ones were the nodes, the data of B, let's see again, and they are backed up in other three nodes. So when B is died, these backups are promoted. So they go, they are now owned by their new owners. And when they own this data, this is a new data, right? This is this one has came from the backup. So now this one doesn't have a backup right now. So it owns this data and send its backup again. Okay, it sends its data. Of course, every node will send its backups and the recovery is complete. Okay, let's back to the slides. Do you have any questions about this repartitioning? Yeah. Okay, yeah. I should have changed. Okay. Okay. Okay, let's continue. Hazelcast has different deployment options. What we have seen so far, it was all started members were servers. They hold data. And when you are trying to use Hazelcast as a cache as a service, so you need to access it from different platforms. And you need a centralized server farm, Hazelcast cluster, which we have been doing since start of this presentation. Then you need to connect this cluster using clients. So you have two deployment options. One is client server architecture and the other one is embedded architecture. Embedded architecture is what we have been doing in this presentation. And you also have ability to connect this cluster from clients. Embedded Hazelcast is very useful when you are developing the application, since it just starts with your application, right? So you don't need to do any other configuration, or you don't need to create another environment to run the cluster. It starts with your application. In client server mode, you might want to try to connect Hazelcast not only from Java. It's possible to connect using C++ clients, .NET clients, Python, or now we have open sourced the client connection protocol, so you can write your own clients in any language and connect to Hazelcast cluster. Any questions about deployment options or any other thing? Okay. Now, as you have seen, the nodes see each other seamlessly without any configuration. This is done by multicasting. So when Hazelcast starts, it multicasts through the network and waits answers from other Hazelcast members. They are also listening to that multicast group. You can define it. And they join each other without having any additional configuration. But most of the time, multicast is not enabled in most of the networks. The network admins doesn't allow it. I don't know why. It is evil, right? So we have TCP/IP option here. You list your server's TCP/IP, add your configuration, and it directly connects to that IP. You don't need to add all servers to the config. If you add only one running member, they will find each other using their connected members. Beyond your local network, Hazelcast also works in cloud environments. We have out-of-the-box provider for AWS servers, which, again, when you enter your credentials, you configure your credentials and your network zones, they can, again, automatically find each other. Also, coming with 3.6, we will provide a new discovery API, which allows you to write plugins that provides connectivity options between in any cloud provider, like Kubernetes or Compute Engine, whatever you want. Question? You have first nodes are you have this group name and password things. The basic level of security is this, so you cannot listen events from if you don't know the group name and password. And also beyond that, you can enable SSL or symmetric encryption. Now let's see the other features of Hazelcast. We have seen that map, and beyond map, we, as I said before, we have implemented Java collection APIs, most of the Java collection API, like map, list, set, queue. Also, Hazelcast is a JCache provider. Have anyone heard JCache before? Okay, JSR 107, I guess. It's an infamous thing that lasts for, I think, 15 years or something to be accepted. So now finally it is accepted, and Hazelcast is one of the first providers for JCache. As I mentioned before, we have high density memory store, which keeps the data off heap. Not on the JVM heap. If you have a very large heap, you will probably face with long GC pauses. So you can use high density memory store. You can use Hazelcast as Hibernate second level cache, which is very easy to configure again. Also, you can use Hazelcast is your web session replication provider. We have three implementations for web session replication. I think I wrote two here. One of them is Tomcat, one of them is Jetty, and one of these are enterprise session replication providers. When you use this, you don't need to configure your application logic. You only need to configure your server's configuration files and register Hazelcast as a session application provider and don't touch your code. And then also we are providing an open source version, which is filter-based, and it is also so powerful that since it's filter-based, you can use it in any container. You are not restricted with Tomcat and Jetty. You can use it everywhere, every web container. You can search map using predicate API and use a Java SQL-like queries. For example, you get map age greater than 10, for example, if you have an age field in your value in your class, you can use it like SQL. You can also, there's persistence. You can save your maps to disk, or read data from disk to load the map when it's starting, for example. There are two options there. This is one of them is write through, and one of them is write behind. Write through means when you put an entry to the map, it goes through this map store, which it's an interface. You need to implement it depending on your database platform, or depending on how you want to save the data. It goes through that interface and waits until the commit is completed and returns then. So you have synchronous backup in the database, for example. But of course, this is this will be slow, and you can use write through, which is asynchronous. Okay, lots of things here. Do we have time? I don't know. Okay. Let's finish this slide. Okay, there is also eviction. If you can define eviction policies on the map and cache, so that they can evict after. You can define TTL. You can define access policies, and we have near cache functionality, which is if you think that the data is not modified so frequently, the node, when a node sends a request to get the data from another node, it can cache it in its local and use that local for a time. You can define again eviction for it, but of course from consistency point of view, it will be problematic. If you know that your data is not so frequently updated, you can use that functionality. We have transaction supports. For example, you can, like databases, when you call it a map put in a transaction context, if transaction rollback, that put will also be rollbacked. Okay. Sorry? No, there are transaction supporting data structures in Hazelcast. For example, transactional map, you need to use that. You can't use the normal map there. There are two supported here, right? Two supported data structures right now. This is one of its transactional map, and the other one is transactional queue. You cannot. Yeah, it's possible.
I start the transaction, I make the first put, the second put, yes.
Yes. Yeah, there are different isolation levels you can choose from. Another feature is wide area network replication. If you have clusters throughout the world, for example, one in Paris, one in London, you can replicate data between clusters. And also we support memcached interface. If you have memcached, if you are using memcached protocol, you can use that interface to access data. Let's have a break. Okay. Any questions before leaving? Nothing will happen, because it is serialized and it's not object reference anymore. So you need to put that again to reflect the latest change.